plan was to do a series of videos about mental health. That still is going to happen, apart from it's not going to be in order anymore. What's happened is a lot of people have been messaging me, obviously stuck in isolation, not feeling very good, and they just want to see some videos, so I've decided to just do little small chunks. They're not edited. I have no idea how to edit things, and I just don't think it's the time to be like, oh, postpone it, just to find someone to edit things. So it's just me talking. The first video is going to be me talking to a good friend of mine, Joe Tinkler. Joe is 23, he's male, and he's been suffering for about a year now. He's very good and talks quite open about his experiences. He has undergone therapy, actually, I think he's still going through therapy, and he has been to his GP, and he talks about telling his friends that he's suffering and telling his parents as well. Please be kind when these videos go up, because obviously that's a hard thing for anyone to talk about. Yeah, he's much more professional than me talking in the camera. I'm really, really awkward. I don't think I'll ever get used to this, so please excuse the fact that I'm so cringy. After this video, they will be more posted by next week.
Oh, we all just need this is a PDSU.
Yeah. Ooh. Ooh. Just put this one on. Put a bit of beeves on.
It looks like we're doing a carpool karaoke.
Yeah, it does. Which one's Corden? I guess me.
Yes. No, I'm driving, so I'm Corden.
You're nowhere near fab enough. 2 years ago, the only thing I was planning for in the future was going back to America. So I left this job I'd had at the pub for like 5 years. Turns out it was the only job I've ever liked. I've had two jobs since and they were both garbage. I'll try and keep the swearing to a minimum. But yeah, worked at this office job down the bay, hated every second of it. Luckily, they sacked me, thank God.
Luckily.
Luckily they sacked me. We disappeared off the dam that weekend as well.
Yeah.
Best time of my life.
And I cried for like 24 hours.
She cried for 24 hours. Literally thought the floods in these days are bad. You should have seen the floods those days. Jesus Christ. And then yeah, so then I got this this other job, which was just like really boring, like factory work, whatever, you know, thanks man. But like I could sort of deal with it because I knew what was coming. Went for a break up in that time, but I think my head was so preoccupied with the summer, it didn't really soak in as much as it should have done. Anyway, summer comes around, go to Barca for a week with my friends, come back 2 weeks later, off to America for 2 months.
Living your best life.
Exactly, living my best life. Just go and see all the gang again, all the girls, all the guys. Just loving life for those 2 months. Best time ever. Then I came back, and that's when I really realised that I had no idea what I was going to do next. Like, I had no idea what I was going to do. That's when like sort of the breakup hit, and then that's when how much I really didn't like Cardiff or anything just sort of hit me. Wasn't really seeing the friends that often, and yeah, it also is just like several things all just piled on at once.
Yeah.
And I couldn't cope.
Why you gone?
It's a really deep conversation. I can't stay serious for such a long period of time. Anyway, yeah, so I remember I remember the date, I still remember, I'm always going to remember the date, it was October 25th, October 25th was when it all hit me, was when it all fell apart, and that was because I went, football team I played for at the time had an away day up in Aberystwyth.
I actually remember this day, Super Bowl day, was it?
No.
Oh, it was the day you've seen Sam, was that the day?
No.
There's been so many days.
Anyway, so October 25th, I go up to Aberystwyth on an away day with my football team. Don't know why, just messaged my ex. Oh, I'm in the area, blah, blah, blah. I haven't talked to her months or anything, I know. I never done it. It's my first breakup, I never done it before.
Self-sabotage, that
Oh my god, yeah, literally. Literally. Just tripping myself up. And yeah, we said some stupid things that we shouldn't have said to each other in the situation we were in. I'm not going to go into details, I don't need. And then that's when it all sort of just then hit me about her moving on. Her moving on, and then her like moving on with her life, and then like new place, new people. And then I was just sort of stuck in the same place, with a football team I didn't like, with a job I didn't like. And yeah, then it's just like, that's sort of just when the anxiety started. Throughout that following week then, I felt a bit funny, but I was going to London that weekend for American football, which is when I met Sam.
So yeah. I got connections.
You're a week,
I do remember.
You're a week after. Yeah. you're a week ahead of the story. Anyway, so I thought, oh, when I get to London, I'll be absolutely fine. Not the case. London was the worst I've ever felt ever. I don't know why, but I couldn't eat anything, could barely drink anything. Just like, yeah, like the anxiety was just so bad, and I don't really know why. It was just like really terrible stomach cramps like all day. Like, almost went home Saturday night. My dad being there made it worse, because I was like, oh god, he's just going to be having the worst time. He's having the worst time with me, which he was. Luckily, so I didn't go home anyway. Then on the Sunday when we went to the NFL, Sam, I was much, much better. I was actually eating and stuff, because I just had a lot of things taking my mind off it. But then, yeah, after that weekend, then was soon, like, I think it was the week after, or maybe 2 weeks after that weekend, I started therapy.
Think it's good?
I think it's good. Yeah, it sort of like helped me realize a lot of things. It gets better the more you do it.
Yeah.
It gets better because, like, at first you're sort of just talking to someone, but then, like, then eventually you realize that they're sort of like giving you information rather than just listening to you. They're actually giving you information back. So the last time I went, it's the best time I went, because she was just saying, like, at the end of the day, like, when you go to London, you'll be in uni, so you'll be really busy. And right now, all you're doing is just, like, working. That's your only responsibility right now. So, like, just enjoy this, like, down chill time you have. I'm like, oh, my God, yeah. Time's been a huge help as well. It's been, like, I don't know how many months now. It's been several months.
Yeah.
But that's just helped in general. Just, like, help me sort of just get back to normal, really.
Yeah.
But then, like, as soon as then at my old job, then, like, because it was so monotonous and boring, like, it wasn't keeping my mind, like, occupied.
Yeah.
So then, like, I'd always start feeling anxious in work about shit. And then, like, I had to go home once or twice just because of how bad I was feeling. But then I went back to the pub then. When did I start back up there? November time, I want to say. Yeah, November, I think it was. Started back up there. Best decision ever. Left the football team, joined a new one. Best decision ever. And then, yeah, since then, it's just sort of just been keeping myself as busy as possible. I've never been as busy as I am now.
Yeah.
Like, in life. Like, honestly, like, I work loads. I keep trying to, like, do things, like, every single day. Like, just whatever
so
activities.
Just, like, distract yourself.
Literally,
really?
Just distracting myself, keeping myself busy all the time.
Yeah.
Before, like, I couldn't really have any downtime on my own because everything would just start, like, closing in. That's got much better now.
Yeah.
The only thing I'm really struggling with at the moment is sleep. I can sleep, but, like, I keep going to bed late, waking up early.
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, like, I just keep trying to do things that I know I'll enjoy, like buying last minute concert tickets.
Yeah. 1975.
Oh my god, best decision I've ever made.
It'd be really ideal now if it was on blast and I could be like,
yeah, we could just, like, yeah, we could just morph into that next scene.
I would sing if I could sing, but no.
Yeah, I can sing, so, but I'm not going to. You don't deserve my talents.
Would you ever consider taking sick from work for your mental health?
No.
No?
No, I wouldn't, just because, I think if I lived on my own, I would.
Yeah.
But because I live with my mum and dad, they wouldn't be happy with me doing it.
Yeah.
My mum's dealt with anxiety for ages and ages and ages. And
yeah.
As far as I know, she's never taken sick work sick days off for it.
Yeah.
Because she just keeps saying, oh, as soon as you're in work, then everything, you know, it just gets better. Yeah. And it does. Like, when I've gone, when since I've been back at the pub, I've rocked up to work having a full-blown panic attack. But then, like, an hour or so in, then I just calm down.
Yeah,
just because, like, I'm in, like, a in an environment that I enjoy.
Yeah. But what about, you know, the job you hated? Do you consider it then, or is it just, like, obviously when you feel sick, you'd fall in sick, but then when some for some reason we wouldn't do the same if we were, you know, having
Because it's, like, when you're having a panic attack, it's, like, I don't know, because it's because you're not on the toilet all morning throwing up or whatever, you're still, like, you can still function in a way. Not well, obviously, but you're not, like, you're not worried about, like, spreading germs or anything like that. Because obviously, because the thing is, right, with mental health, the majority of people, if not all people, experience it later on in life.
Yeah.
So until that point, you're only taught that sick days are for when you're throwing up, when you're really ill, when you're coughing, sneezing, feel like crap, like fever temperature. So then when you're just feeling like depressed or anxious or having a panic attack, you don't know whether it's a valid reason to get off work, just because you haven't, you've never, like, really been in that situation, and you don't think it's, like, you've not been told it's a valid reason, basically, so you don't think it's one.
That's true.
It was just like with when I was in that office job I really hated, because it was only a 1 year internship, that's why I stayed. If it was something like I actually applied for and planned to be there for several years, I would have quit so much sooner.
Yeah.
But just because, like, it's only for a year, and my parents kept drilling into me, it's only for a year, and I was like, oh, I'll stay for a year. Thankfully. Yeah. Thankfully, I had to stay for 7 months.
That was a great weekend for us, wasn't it?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
Breakdown Central.
Yeah. Oh god, that weekend, that's so much drama. Before and after it.
Yeah. So we went to Amsterdam, the day before we went, sacked.
Basically, yeah, so we were leaving for Amsterdam on the Friday. I got sacked on the Thursday, but I still stayed for those optional 2 weeks. I don't know why. I'm not a quitter. I'm a sacker. Anyway, so sacked on Thursday, crazy snow on then Thursday night, Friday. Flight's cancelled on the Friday. We're rushing about trying to get new flights. We find a flight from Birmingham Saturday morning. So me and Mol head up to Birmingham Friday night. Had a great evening.
Great evening. Great time. Trying to chill me out.
Watched the car ride there was quite stressy for Molly. I was just chilling out.
I was just crying. He had his, like, headphones on.
Yeah.
And, like, really enjoying his music while I was having a breakdown looking out the window thinking, oh my god, I genuinely can't cope right now.
Watched Wales beat France in the Six Nations, and then some bloke came over to us saying, oh, you're a lovely, oh no, why am I doing the Welsh voice, he was from Birmingham. He goes, oh, you're a lovely couple, get off your phones. And we just looked at him, mate, we're not a couple, so we'll do what we want.
I was like, one, we're not a couple, two, I'm really, really stressed, you don't want to mess me right now.
Yeah, if I put my arm around her, she'd bite it off, mate. Anyway, fly out Saturday morning. Go to Ireland, meet the gang.
No, you're missing the part where we sat on the plane and then the plane.
The plane wouldn't take off. Yeah, because they were missing pilots or something, and then I can't remember. It was a lot.
Another breakdown for me when I was crying out the window whilst Joe again was just listening to his headphones.
I'm a very naive person. I think, oh, it's gonna happen. Like, well, it's gonna happen. It did happen. I had a great weekend. Went to the Anne Frank Museum. Way overrated.
Yeah, that's another one I had a breakdown over again.
Way overrated. I'm happy I've done it. I can tell people I've done it, but I don't know how they got found. Neither did the Anne Frank lot. So, and then, yeah, came back then on the Sunday. Was it delayed?
Yeah.
Delayed flight. But who cares? We're going home, so who cares about delayed flight? Watched the Super Bowl then Sunday night. Great times. On my own, obviously. Dad was asleep. But, yeah, no, that was... Yeah, that weekend.
That was such a stressful
weekend. Yeah. Oh my god, yeah. No, the stress didn't end there. Because then I had my ex to deal with at the time as well.
Oh, yeah.
Because obviously she wasn't happy with me going to Amsterdam with you.
Fun times.
Oh my god. Like, the thing is, right, I was so hung up on her, and in a way I still am. And that was, like, probably, as well as everything else, like, me not being happy with the situation with work and life and everything. the breakup was definitely like the spark and all that, because like it was my first long-term relationship, hadn't done anything like that before, hadn't been through a breakup before. So in my head, I'm just like, she's having the best time ever. She's meeting all these new people, doing this, doing that. Meanwhile, I'm just stuck here doing nothing. Confidence rock bottom. But thinking about it, like thinking about all the things I'm now sort of able to do with her not in the picture. Like, for example, if I was still with her when we went to that 1975 concert and if she's seen us Instagram with me and four other girls, she would have lost her mind. Lost her mind. And it was like the... Arguably, it's good. Like, to have a better night than that this year is going to take some topping. Because yeah, that was unbelievable.
Unexpected,
night.
That wasn't it?
Oh my god, like, honestly, like, it's just all everything just lined up. Everything just lined up. Oh, Joe, when are you going to see the 1975 tonight? Oh, me too. Oh, I'll see you there then, obviously. At my first TGIs. Only a beer, though.
Yeah, you had a beer and a TGI. Beer. That's not really.
It looked cool, though. You should have seen how cool I looked.
Right.
Yeah, back on topic.
Yeah, back on did you ever go to see your GP about it?
Yes, I went to see my GP once. I had to leave work early because it was my old crap job, just because like obviously the work was so mundane, boring, repetitive. The anxiety was just like just getting too much, so I left work, went to the GP. And the GP just basically said, oh, it sounds like you're doing everything you're supposed to be doing in this sort of situation. Seeing a therapist, keep yourself busy. So I don't want to give you something now, because if you start like anti-anxiety medication or antidepressants or anything like that, you've got to finish them off. Like, it's not just a short term, you've got to like take tablets for a while. And then he said, but you know, if it persists, then you know, always, you know, come back and we'll have a chat again about it. So yeah. He just said everything. He said everything he was supposed to say.
Yeah.
I've always had like I never wanted to take tablets. Not because I'm against taking tablets, just because I sort of wanted to just beat it on my own.
Yeah.
Other than having to rely, because I sort of noticed that when at the worst point, I was sort of just like talking to loads of people about it. But rather than sort of like doing something about it, I'd just talk to them and then I'd feel a bit better. And then as soon as I started feeling crap again, I started just talking to people again. And then I really hated that.
Yeah.
I really hated just popping up to people saying like, I don't feel right, I don't feel good. Because like, I don't want to keep like messaging people like just really depressing things. Just like, I feel shit, I feel crap, I feel sad, I feel this. So then I eventually stopped doing that and started doing more real world things, getting out there as much as I could, doing as much as I could, which has helped so much. I haven't messaged anyone about feeling crap for ages now.
Yeah.
Because there's just no need to.
What about, I was speaking to a few people now, and like, what everyone says, I was young and suffering, and obviously about like telling your parents like how hard that is, that you're down and
yeah,
but you struggle with that, you know?
No, not at all. As soon as I felt weird, the first thing I did was text my mum.
Yeah,
I was like feeling, it was a Wednesday and I had work in the afternoon. I was just messing my mum, I don't remember going to work today, mum. She's like, why not? I said, because I just feel terrible, I just feel like really anxious, just feel like really panicky, I don't know what's up. She was like, but then she just said, oh, go to work, you'll feel better. And I went to work, I felt a bit better, but I didn't feel great. And then obviously I just deteriorated from there. But like telling my parents wasn't hard. Telling anyone, like I know how people always say that for men especially, it's hard to like tell people, but for me it was never an issue.
Yeah.
I told like everyone I knew.
Yeah.
I just wasn't feeling right. Just because I'd never done anything, like I'd never had anything like this happen before. So it was just sort of like, well, the logical thing to do is just to tell people. It's like you tell people when you're sick, and tell people when you're feeling down. Like,
yeah.
A mate of mine had told us before. He hadn't told us that much, but he now and then tell us how he was sort of dealing with this and that. But he kept it locked up much more than he should have done. But I've noticed ever since I sort of came about telling people about how I was feeling, he's been a lot more open with how he's been doing as well. Obviously, which is good for him. But I mean, he's in my opinion, he's probably in the best time of his life right now, because like he's got like a decent internship, but he's already looking to leave that because he knows it's only like a temporary thing. He's got a missus, he's got a good haircut, he's going to the gym frequently, he's eating well, he's cutting down on his drinking, so you know, he's living his healthiest life anyway at the moment. But no, like telling parents, telling other people was never an issue for me.
Yeah. What's like the most annoying thing that someone's ever said to you after you told them?
Oh, I tell you. Oh, that's an easy one. Easiest thing. Oh, do you want to get back with her? Worst thing anyone ever said, could say, has said to me. That was the worst thing. At first, when people would say that to me, that would then send me into like anxiety, panic attacks all over again. Because then it put doubt in my mind. Like, oh, maybe we could, even though we shouldn't, because I just have to think back to when we did break up, and it was definitely the right thing to do at that time, 100%.
Yeah.
If I could go back to that day, like, I'd know how I was feeling, so, like, it was the right thing to do. But no, like, the worst thing, oh, no, you could try and get back with her, I'm sure she'd want to. It's like, well, she told me she doesn't.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I can't.
Yeah, so it's not a
possibility. And like, even though like we've, you know, put it to bed, nail in the coffin type thing, you just saying that is just then going to put doubt in my mind, which is going to make me freak out.
Yeah.
Which it did several times. There's still times now like where I think I'm not still ready to see her again.
Yeah.
Like my therapist last time, she even said like, because I said to her, oh, I'm so lucky that she moved away and I can't see her, because like I just feel like I could have a panic attack if I saw her again. But then my therapist was like, yeah, but seeing her again might not be like, not like on purpose, but like accidentally seeing her again might not be the worst thing, because then you'd realize that she's not, you know, doing as amazing as you think she's doing. Like, she might be, but the odds are she probably isn't. So like, but still, like, I'm like, when I first started back at the pub, like, her mum goes up there all the time. So I see her mum all the time, which isn't the end of the world. Like, it's not the worst thing. But then her brother, a few weeks ago, came up and gave his CV up there. And I'm like, not a fucking chance. No chance. Do not do that. He hasn't been back since then, God. But I always worried that if she just walked through the door, like, the pub, she wouldn't. Because, like, when she worked there, she never made mates with anyone. And she didn't get along with anyone. She hates it there.
Yeah.
And I love it there. So that should have been a sign. But no, like, I just thought, like, oh, if she walked through that door now, I'd have a full-blown panic attack if I saw her.
Yeah, but it's probably, you know, because you've imagined this so much, normally it's worse in your head than it actually ever is when it happens. So, like, you build yourself up about something, and then when it happens, you're like, oh, okay.
100%.
That didn't hurt as much as I thought it would be, because you built it up so much.
Like, one of the best things that's helped me cope with it is just to tell myself that I wasn't going to marry her. Which I wasn't. Yeah. Like, I wasn't going to marry her. And then it's like, well, then you were sort of just not wasting your time, because obviously I don't regret, like, being with her at all. But no, like, I wasn't going to marry her. I knew that.
Yeah.
And when I think about it, we weren't really that compatible as well. Because, like, me and you were, like, best mates.
Yeah.
And we are much better mates than me and her were. Which isn't right.
Yeah.
Which is probably why she was so jealous of you. Ooh! No, like, and that's what it is. It's like, you just gotta be, you can't be thinking like, oh, I'm much better friends with other people than I am with this girl. That's not right.
Yeah,
But one thing I told my therapist early days was that, because I generally didn't think I'd meet anyone again after that, which is like the stupidest thing to say ever. And I know how stupid I felt stupid to say, but like,
23, that's it.
Exactly.
That's
my
clock.
Nobody likes you when you're 23. But one of the reasons why I thought that was because when I first met her, it was like an instant sort of like instant attraction. Like, like, I'm gonna flirt outrageous with you, I wanna go out with you, everything like that.
Yeah.
And I just was worried that I wasn't gonna have that again.
Yeah.
But whatever.
Whatever.
A time will come. I'm in my prime. I'm in my prime. I'm in my Optimus.
And you like all this music? Summer 40, need an ice tray. Cheesecake for my waddies on the highway. Replay. Awful taste of music, bless him.